all been well. He says confidently. Should have started it. Oh yeah, there we go. We're starting. Right, so we're recording, as I said, for those that aren't able to be here tonight. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to try and share this PowerPoint with you, so please bear with me while I have a look at my wonderful technological skills, which you all know what I'm like on this. So referee mentors workshop, that looks promising. Right, you don't see that's right at the end. So I'm going to click on that. Is that showing for you guys?
Yes.
Cool. Excellent. Okay. So the workshop, as such, as I say, is an abridged version of what has been delivered in person, far more interactive than what you're going to get tonight. But I'm just giving you what I feel are the most important bits to be aware of when you are out mentoring. So just a couple of little bits around that. Who's waiting in the lobby? Let's let some people into the lobby. Ian Butler's here. Lovely. Good. Is it, you can still see it, guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
Okay. Yeah, still see it.
Right. Hi Ian, right.
Hi, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm good, mate. I'm good. Thanks for joining us. Right. Okay, so the idea of this group, really, just to put a bit of context on it, is it was a group that we decided to form because the FA are very conscious of the dropout in refereeing when people reach sort of 16, 17, 18, up to sort of mid-20s. So what they decided to do was that they gave each county a bit of financial support and direction to try and work around this, to try and improve the situation. The other thing that they were mindful of is that whilst we do some mentoring for guys when they do their initial training and for the first couple of games, it tends to drop off after that, really. And then it doesn't really get picked up much until those of you that are, well, most of you are now in a coaching group or other. So the 5 to 4s, there's some coaching there, the level 4s as well. And so those of you that are in core, it sort of doesn't get picked up until that level. So there's a big gap in between, really. And what this is about is trying to keep the 16 to 24-year-olds involved, trying to develop them, and ultimately trying to get them, if they're not already, to be involved in officiating adult football. So one of the precursors, when I went out to, I wrote to all of the 16 to 24-year-olds and said, right, would you like to be involved in this group? Would you like some extra mentoring support? Have you got aspirations to get involved in adult football if you're not already? So they've all come back and said, yes, they already are in adult football, or yes, they would like to get into adult football. So at the moment, there's 17 of them in the group. That may get a little bit bigger. I don't want it to go more than sort of 22, 24, maybe at the most. I mean, there's about 30 of you that have expressed an interest, which is fantastic. But you're not all going to be involved immediately, but you will be as time goes on. But I want you to be up to speed, hence why we're doing this. So that's a little bit of background. Anybody want to ask any questions on that before we move on? Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. Let's go on to the next slide then. So, scope of your role, potentially, I know some of you have done some mentoring for the newbies and the younger ones. So the scope of a mentor generally is, as you can see there, looking at performance, giving some feedback, maybe just being a shoulder to lean on. That's certainly that's what we talk about with those early days, or someone on the end of the phone, helping the new refs, as we said, for the early stages of the journey, perhaps supporting and picking up a referee when they're having a bad patch. or working with an experienced referee officiating adult football for the first time. So we're more towards that last one, really. That's where this group's tent will sit. But as I say, there will be some scope to work outside of that as well. Okay. Little bit of interaction here then, guys. I'm going to just come out of here a sec if I can. So, value of great mentors. Anybody like to sort of fill in the gaps there, really, of what does the first line say? So unmute yourselves if you want, rather than sending in answers. So what are we looking to get out of our referees, that first point? Anyone?
A better, more consistent referee?
Yeah, absolutely right. Well, better, more confident. Consistent would fit as well. Yeah, I'll go with that. A better, more confident referee the following week. Okay. What about the second
I'll take the easy one. A referee who wants to be better.
Right. Well done, mate. Thank you. Yeah, absolutely right. Third one. What are we looking at? This is all to do with the relationship.
Positive, Rog.
Yeah, positive. A referee who is positive towards the referee mental relationship. So again, that sort of bit there is just sort of re-emphasizing the fact that it's a two-way street. And this is the bit I'm going to emphasize when we have another meeting with you and the referees together is that this has to work. You will support them equally. They've got to buy into what you're trying to do in order for it to be successful. So that's important. Fourth one.
Turn.
What are we looking for them to do?
Turn.
Turn out, yeah. A referee will turn out the following week. So again, going back to that point I made with the FA's expectations, they want to encourage more retention of the 16 to 24 year old group. And obviously them getting better, enjoying it more, wanting to referee more. That's the sort of longer term aim of it. Okay. Fifth one.
Potential.
Yeah. Okay. A referee's potential to progress, certainly, beyond his or her current level. So again, whilst at the moment, as I say, that the only sort of requirement I asked for the guys when I invited them into this group was I want you to be aiming to get involved in adult football. Of course, my longer term aspiration is if they're a level 7 now, is that they actually put in for promotion to try and go to 6. And again, with your support, we'd like to think they've got a better opportunity of that happening. So that's important as well. Equally, your feedback's important. You're feeding back to me as to how they're getting on, or crikey, they're showing real potential. Oh, no, I'm not sure, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. And last one.
Happier players and a better game.
Absolutely right. Yeah, because let's not forget, when we're looking at the whole picture, if our officials are doing better, it's a win-win all round. Everyone's happy with things. And that's ultimately what we're trying to get back to. Interestingly, sort of linked into this, and some of you will remember this, some of you will not, but there was a massive inquiry that the Army had after, unfortunately, there were some fatalities at Deep Cut Barracks in Surrey. And it was about the whole way that the Army trained their soldiers as they were sort of coming into the army. And basically, the sort of finding summarised it in that the army would now have changed their emphasis on training people to become better soldiers and be part of the army rather than trying to weed people out, because they were putting people under a really sort of difficult situation and almost like pushing people out that they didn't think were for fit for purpose. And that was obviously in some individuals' opinions. What we're trying to do ultimately is in that group, and I haven't sort of analysed them with any real detail yet, you're going to have some that, quite frankly, could shoot on to really good things. Some might just actually go on to be level sevens and do a good job in adult football. I am happy either way. The bottom line is we're getting them enrolled in adult football. We're keeping them in refereeing. They will be better. They will enjoy it more. And that's what we're all about. OK, anybody got any questions, any comments at that point? That makes sense. Okie doke. Let's move on then. So next slide is all about establishing rapport. So what do you think that actually means, anybody? What do we mean by rapport?
Building trust.
Yeah, absolutely. Good. Okay, what else?
Being approachable.
Definitely. Yeah, being approachable. And ultimately, this group are obviously of a certain age. So hence why I've gone to you as a group to ask for your help around this. With the best will in the world, whilst we've got some older mentors in the county that do a great job for us in supporting referees, I think sometimes that's quite hard for someone who's in their 60s, 70s maybe, who has done a lot of refereeing, isn't active now, to look after a 16, 17 year old. Because whilst the advice they might give them is great, they might not be able to relate to them in the same way. And that's not a sweeping statement, but that is just something that I think sometimes makes it a bit harder. Whereas you guys, even Mike Holford's not that old, you know. So,
hey, hang on.
Need another facelift, though, I think.
you are current, you're doing it. And I'd like to think they will all look to you to think, this guy's refereeing as a level five. He's going to get his level four. This guy is a level four. He's going to go on further, et cetera, et cetera. So they'll look to you in terms of what you're doing. And with the best will in the world, you've got that credibility. And that's where I think, again, that's really, really important. And that ability as well to sort of link into them. So that's one element. Anything else around rapport then, guys? So we've got trust, ability to get on with them. What else?
Having the confidence to be able to approach them as well. It's not about sort of being approachable, but making the mentee feel confident and comfortable in coming to you anyway.
Yeah, absolutely right. And that is so, so important that they've got that confidence to do that. If they're not confident to talk to you or to communicate with you, you know, by email or whatever, it's not going to work. It has to be a two-way street. If you are pulling teeth, for want of a better word, as the mentor, and it's always you that's sort of leading conversations and forcing the issue almost, you've got to wonder whether it's working. Okay, so rapport makes them more comfortable to do that, and I think that's really, really important. Okay, and there's lots of different ways we can do it. And again, you know, if we're on the workshop, we do an exercise around this, but in essence, it's just sometimes just trying to find that common ground. So you know, when you're out as match officials and you're working with someone for the first time, when you're having that sort of chat beforehand, that's what you're doing. You're always trying to find that common ground. What is it that you've got in common? Well, you like football to start with, so that's always a really simple one. But it's, you know, it's stuff like, what other interests maybe have you got? And it might be just a little bit of small talk. That's lo and behold, you might find, for example, Snarty, a good friend of mine, likes cricket. I like cricket. So irrespective of whether we talk about football, we'll end up talking about cricket as well, probably, because we like that. So it's just little things like that that always, always help that sort of rapport building and make things just a bit easier, because they're comfortable to talk about something they're interested in. All right. So it's little stuff like that. OK, let's move on then. So that's establishing rapport. The next one, and again, I don't really want to teach you how to suck eggs, but this is all about first impressions. So ultimately, the first impressions you guys are going to get on when you're actually meeting these guys for the first time will probably be in that meeting in January, all being well. So you're not going to meet them physically to start with, but when you do, it's how you set the tone. And again, you know, I'm sure you've all heard this, but it takes between 3 and 5 seconds for someone to form a first impression of you. Now, that can be a positive one or otherwise. Okay, so it's really, really important that that you're able to do that, and it's a positive first impression that you make. So that might be things in terms of how you're dressed, how smart you are, etc., what you say, and so on. Okay, so it's just, again, thinking about that, especially that they are younger people, for those of you that aren't as young, and how are you going to do that so that you're not sort of putting them off before you've even started, all right? They need to be confident in you and see that you are approachable, like what we've all been touching on a minute ago, from the outset to take things forward. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah, okay. Right, can you see on the screen the three tens? Is that up there now? Can you see that?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So this is something, this is a fairly new idea, but it's, I think it's quite a good one. And again, it, as I said, I'll send you these, the notes, so you can see what they are. So this is all about first impressions. So the three tens relates to, first one, first ten, how you look to the other person from 10 feet away. So dress sense, body language, how you compare to things they value. So for example, one of my pets is, and my kids are terrible at this at the moment, because where they are in school, they're in these bubbles and they always have to congregate on what was a grassy area. But of course, at this time of year, it's just a mud heap. So every flipping day they go to school, I make sure their shoes are clean. Every day they come home as if they've been walking through the Somme, quite frankly. And it just annoys me. I just don't like to see people with dirty shoes, is what it is. So again, it's just thinking about that. And you know, I mean, if that's one of your pets, and that's what it is. But again, it's how do you come across? Do you turn up with, you know, it's like on game day, do we turn up with dirty boots, or do we actually make an effort and turn up with boots that actually are fit for purpose and make a decent first impression? So that's the first one. So that's the first 10. Second one is the 10 inches from the top of your head to your chin. Okay, so without sort of trying to confuse you here, this is about how you come across facially. So what's your facial expression? What sort of eye contact have you got? Do you smile? Do you look genuine? Do you look interested? Do you look with anticipation about the fact that you've met this person and you're looking to do some good work in supporting them? Okay, so that's the second 10. The final 10, and I did touch on it a moment ago, is the first 10 words you say. So, you know, are you going to tell them how you can help them? Or are you actually going to go in there and talk about what a wonderful refereeing career you've had, blah, blah, blah? We've all heard it. Funny enough, I was chatting to Richard Glyn-Jones, who wrote the workshop earlier about the new referee course next year. And Richard lives in Bristol, and his son plays, they've got a team that play in the Bristol Saturday Youth League. I think they're about under 10s now, and he runs the team. And he said he gets some really good young referees on that league and some that are not so good. And he said one of the things that always winds him up when the first thing that a young referee says to him is, when am I going to get my 20 quid? You know, that's the opening gambit. So you can imagine that puts him off straight away. So again, think about those the three tens, 10 feet away, your 10 inches from the top of your head to your chin, and your first 10 words. Because honestly, as I say, once you've made that first impression, it's blooming hard, if not impossible, to undo it. Right. Okay. So the next point I want to go on to then is, if I can find my notes here, is questioning and listening. So again, obviously, within a mentor-mentee relationship, you are going to be having to ask some questions. I'm not really touching on coaching as such tonight, but again, this is very coach-related. in that if you give them all the answers, you try and give them all the answers, it's not going to work for you. You have to try and ask some questions and get them to think for themselves, and sometimes to try and put their own solutions in, perhaps with your support, that ultimately will take them forward. Okay. As mentors, that's what mentors are. You've got the experience and knowledge to pass on, but equally, if we can get something from them to themselves to buy into, it makes it a lot easier. So with that in mind, it's asking the right questions, and also then when you've done that, making sure that you're listening. Okay, so we've got the two examples up there, and for some of you, this will be me teaching you to suck eggs because you know all about closed and open and probing questions. For others, it might not be so obvious. Okay, one of the things I want to make quite clear here, and again, sometimes this gets wrongly communicated, is that closed questions aren't a bad thing at the right time. Open and probing questions are a good thing, but again, not always at the wrong time. So it's getting that balance right and thinking about when you're going to use them. So what do we mean, first of all, then, quick question for you, what do we mean by closed questions? What do we summarize those as, anybody?
Something along the lines of, is it raining?
Thank you, Mike. Yeah, so basically stuff with a yes or no or a one word answer normally. Yeah, that's that you're going to just finish off that, because the whole clue there is they're closed because they can't go anywhere. Once you've given that answer, that's it. It's finished. OK, great. So when might we use the closed question? When is that going to help us? Anyone?
When you're clarifying events that happened in a game, i.e. did you send off red six?
Perfect.
Was it blue eight?
Right. Yeah, great. So summarising facts. So you might have gone through and got some information. You're then pulling it together and you're saying, so what you're saying is blah, 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 yes or no. Yeah. Perfect. Lovely. OK. So, and again, the point there is there is definitely a place for those, for clarity, to confirm exactly where we are. What about open and probing questions then? What do we mean by those?
As beloved by assessors, can you talk me through why you did that?
Okay, right. Yeah. So again, excuse me. They are open in that, as you say, what, where, why, who, when. Tend to have that how. Those are the sort of open questions. Probing is where you go in a bit deeper. So what you're saying is blah, blah, blah. So can you tell me a little bit more about that? What about this? You know, and you're digging a little bit deeper. Okay. So again, time and place for them, certainly, for sure. But the closed questions then can narrow it down a little bit. Okay. And again, I'm conscious of time. I'm not going to go into this in a load of detail. Some of you will be really adept at using them and you're questioning. Some of you, it'll be something will be a bit newer to you and you need to work on it a little bit. But as Mike says there, you will have heard it in at practice lots of times when you've been observed, or potentially when you've been coached or mentored in the past yourself. So again, just relate back to that experience in terms of how that worked for you. But ultimately, you need to be asking these questions to try and get some information from them that will help them going forward and that will make them realise for themselves, rather than you saying, this is what happened, bang, bang, bang. So it's getting the information from them. OK. Right. With that in mind, there's this little mnemonic that Richard's come up with that I'm going to show you now, called TED Pie. Has anyone come across that before? I'll be honest, I hadn't until he mentioned it to me. But I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but this is along the same sort of lines. So tell me about, explain to me, describe the precisely, in detail, exactly, blah, blah, blah. So they are sort of opening gambits along a sort of open stroke probing type of question that you might follow that up with. Okay, so that's how that one would work. And again, you know, as I said, I'll send this out to you, you have it as reference, and if you've got it there and you want to use it, give it a go. You know, it might be something that that would work for you. So you're trying, it might be involved clarifying something, possibly summarizing it. But every question you use has to have a purpose. So there might be some reflection in there, some reassurance, as we've said, checking for understanding, possibly some engagement. So again, if they're not very forthcoming, you might want to ask them some questions just to come out their shells a little bit and to talk to you a bit more. Okay. Right. Okay, let's go on then to the other part of this, which is listening. And again, I think this is something that, in all honesty, is we tend to be reasonably good at asking questions, but then not very good at listening to people replying to them. Okay. And I always remember that the adage that I was taught when I was covering this many, many moons ago was you've got one mouth and two ears, and if you're using them in that proportion, you're not going to go too far wrong when it comes to questioning and getting your answers. Okay, so let's go back to listening then. So what we've got there are three sort of different levels of listening: peripheral listening, apparent listening, and active listening. So peripheral listening, as you can see there, without sort of insulting your intelligence, is basically stuff that you're sort of half listening to. So it might be something like a situation where you might be at the game, for example, and two other officials are having a chat amongst themselves, and you're sort of half ear wigging in. So you're picking up half of it. You might be in the clubhouse at the end of the game and you hear, you know, the manager talking to one of his players, and you're half here, and you might hear the word referee, and then all you're thinking, oh, what's he saying? You know, so you're only picking up a bit of it. You're not sort of really tuned into what's going on. And, you know, we're all guilty of that at different times, without a shadow of doubt. Okay. The second one there is apparent listening. So you appear to be listening to others without fully being engaged in the conversation. And the example I'll give you on this one is one that we will all be able to relate to, is when we're watching Match of the Day and our partners want to chat to us about something. And they're going, you know, should we go out for lunch tomorrow, dear? And you're going, yeah. You know, so apparently you're listening, but we know you're not really. You're watching Harry Kane's latest goal. So it's you know, it's one of those things that again goes on, and we're all guilty of it. Oh man, I've certainly done it loads of times. My wife's battered me on more than one occasion around that. So that's the second level, which again, thinking about it from a referee's point of, for our mentee's point of view, not very good, clearly, because we're not properly listening. So then we're taking in bits, but not all of it. OK, and then we get to the third level, which is active listening. And this is what we really want to be doing. OK, so when we are active listening, we're hearing the words, and we're also starting to understand the meaning behind them. So one of the way, there's a few different ways that we can demonstrate active listening. But again, without me giving you all the answers, anyone got any experience to this as to how we can demonstrate active listening to people that are
reflecting?
Reflecting, great. Yeah, so reflecting back to them what they've said, perfect. What else?
Summarising.
Yeah, great. So summarising again the key points that they've come up with. Okay. No one paraphrasing, restatement of the factual content, using different words, encouragement. So again, thinking this is sort of coming into body language and eye contact and things like that. If you know, when you've got somebody face to face and you're talking to them, you know, it's a little nod to the head, little expressions. This is why delivering things like this are so blooming hard because I can't see most of you. The ones I can see are doing the right things, which makes me feel positive. But the rest of you could be having your tea now, and I would be none the wiser, quite honestly. So again, that's the sort of thing that, you know, we need to do just to show people we are listening to them. We are taking on board what they're saying, and we're going to demonstrate that because we're going to rephrase it. We're going to summarize it or whatever. What I'm going to try and do now is the next slide on here is something that's from YouTube. I'm going to try and play it and see if I can show this view on the screen. It's only a short little clip, but it's quite funny just to demonstrate the point I was making. So give me 2 seconds. I'll give it a go and see how we get on with this. Right.
It's all gone from the screen now. Your presentation's disappeared.
Yeah, I've taken it off a second. I'm just seeing if I can get it. Is that showing? You see that, guys?
Yeah, we could see the video, Rog, yep. But I can't hear any sound on my end.
All right, okay.
Yeah, same here.
No sound.
What you could do, Rog, is just put the link in the chat and then give us a couple of minutes and we can all just watch it on our screens.
Good shout, mate. Good shout. I like someone who's digging me out of my IT hole. Hold on. Lovely.
Someone who's done team meetings before.
I've done team meetings before, but not shown videos very well, Mike. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Let me do that. Then you can have a moosey at that. Give me 2 seconds.
If you just go onto YouTube and type in it's not about the nail, it comes straight up.
Does it?
Yeah.
Okay, I will equally put it in the chat for everyone else.
Ooh, there we go. Oh, Paul Collier's put it up. And Roger Vaughan's put it up.
Look at me, Paul. There you go. Right, brilliant. Have a go then, guys. Have a look at that. Just summarise that little section quite well while I get back to get my presentation back on. 2 seconds.
That's good, that, Rog.
Yeah. All right. I mean, it's silly, but it's quite funny, but it makes the point, doesn't it? All right.
Yeah, cool. Very clear.
Okay. Cool. Right. Thanks for doing that, guys. Right. Is it back up there now? Is the PowerPoint back up there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. Brilliant. Right. Okay. So that was that. Sorry, someone asked a question there. No. All right, we're going to go on now and just have a quick look at what does it make to be a great mentor? So just again, I'm not going to, this is something that, you know, if we had the sort of physical workshop, we'd go through it and we'd do it that way. I'm not going to spend a massive amount of time on this. I'm just going to show you some potential of the skills, the knowledge and the attributes that maybe you'd want to consider. Okay, and again, as I said, I'll send you this out so you've got these in front of you. But ultimately, knowledge, obviously laws of the game, current refereeing practices, which you've all got, because you're all current referees. Your skills, probably even more important, the ability to identify their strengths and weaknesses. To help the referee to do it, even more important again, as I said, this is back to that questioning and getting them to realise, giving them information, giving them praise as well at the right time, inspiring them and motivating them, hopefully. Writing a report that actually reflects the session. So again, we'll come on to that a little bit later. Managing effective feedback. Again, we'll touch on that in a minute. Listening and questioning, as we mentioned. And then challenging them to improve or perhaps consolidate where they are. So quite a lot around there. Some of it you might think, yeah, that's I'm comfortable with that. There might be parts of that you think, yeah, that's an area I would need to work on, which is fine. That's what it's all about. In terms of your attributes, being able to be encouraging, honest, we've already touched on, approachable, we've touched on, obviously confident. I think empathy is massive, so you need to be empathetic to their situation and where they are. Also being objective. So again, it's ultimately we're all human beings. So it's like when you get an observer that comes out and watches you, ultimately it's still going to be their opinion. Okay. So you know, this is hard sometimes to be objective, but that's what we want to aim for. We've got to be impartial, of course. And the last one there, which is an interesting one, is being referee-centred. What do you think we mean by that? Why do we need to be referee-centred?
Because you need to be concentrating on what the referee's doing more than what the two teams are.
Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah, so it's on their needs, on them as an individual, on their development. And ultimately, it's about they're the guys that are refereeing the game. So it's pointless, you know, saying, oh, if I was out there, this is what I'd be doing and blah, 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 because that's not helpful at all. So it's got to be focusing on them and getting them to consider it for themselves. OK, and that's really, really quite an important point. OK, cool. Next bit, really, and again, I'm not going to spend a huge amount of time on this. But again, I think it's just really to be mindful of it as much as you can. And that's how do people learn? Because people do learn in different ways. So there's a little cartoon up there, which I think is quite apt. I taught Patch how to sing. I don't hear him singing. I said I taught him. I didn't say he learned it. So again, point being, what makes sense to you in the way you're going about delivering your message might not make sense to that individual referee you're supporting. So again, I think that's really, really important to bear that in mind. And it's an interesting example around this, actually, that there was a panel referee a while back called Alan Biggs, who was dyslexic. And once he had a mentor that sent him 4 pages of notes on his performance in a game. It was just like, might as well have sent it in Chinese to him. He didn't have a clue what was going on. Obviously, couldn't read it because he was dyslexic and so on and so forth. So again, it's just making sure that we avoid that sort of situation and think about how we go about giving our message and what's right for that individual referee. And again, that'll be a down to you, finding out from them in the early days when you are supporting them. At this point now, I'm just going to introduce you to a few models that are out there around how people learn. First one is the 70-20-10 model. How many of you have come across that before? Has anyone come across that? No?
Yeah, they use it at our place where I work.
Okay. Does it work?
It's probably true.
Right. Okay.
I think most people learn, you know, it's like an apprenticeship, isn't it? You develop yourself through the experience of actually doing it rather than obviously take exams and that kind of stuff, and you learn through books, but you know, there's a chunk that you learn from doing or from seeing it done and then replicating that.
Yeah, absolutely right. And the point with refereeing really is, I think it's true when you think about it. Bottom line is, I mean, if you think about the way we changed the referee course, those of you that have been involved in it have seen it delivered in recent years, is that we went away from doing it in a sort of theoretical way. I mean, certainly when I went on the course, I'm sure Pete Colley was no different. We did it in a pub. The first time I blew a whistle was my first game. You know, all of the things like that. I never went out on the field of play until I did my first game, etc., etc. And of course, that makes it blooming hard because it's a lot of theory, a lot of stuff you talked about. But until you went out there and did it, it's all new. So this model really is around the fact that 70% of what our referees probably learn and develop is what they get when they're out on their games. Now, obviously, that will be with you, ideally, on occasions, being there with them to support them, to make that learning experience even better. And that's what we're looking for here. So that's 70% of it. The 20% is learning and developing through others. So for me, I'm talking about my own experiences. That was going to RA meetings. So when I first started out, it was Western Supermare RA. And when I was lucky enough to be there when Trevor Cowell was first on the scene, Ron Groves was there. Ron Groves was a Premier League referee. Trevor was on the Premier League line. God knows how many Western League referees, Football League assistants. Chat to them at meetings, I learnt loads. So that was my big 20% really of learning and developing for talking to them. And then the last bit, interestingly, and again, this surprised me when I saw this model, is that really only 10% of what people learn and develop is through courses and programs. So really, I guess the message for you guys here and the importance that you're going to play for these people that you're going to mentor is that they're going to learn a lot more from you being with them and supporting them in their games than anywhere else. And that's really why I think this is such an important program. Okay. So that's the 70-20-10 model. There's a couple of others up there as well. The one on the left is the visual audio, VARC actually, because we've got reading and writing as well now, as well as kinesthetic. And then you've got the one on the right, those of you that have been involved in education, Honey and Mumford, Learning Styles, Pragmatist, Activist, Theorist and Reflector. I'm not going to spend a lot of time running through that one now, but again, it's there. I'll send this out, as I said, if you want to have a look at it. But the key bit around it is that everyone's got a preferred style as to how they want to learn. And it's really just getting you to think about the fact that they might have a different learning style to you. Okay. So we'll just focus on the VARC one for a minute. So the VARC one is people that learn visually. So they like to see stuff, they learn from watching stuff and so on and so forth. The second part, the audio, is again people liking to learn by hearing stuff, so audio stuff. The R, which isn't up there, is people liking to learn by reading stuff or writing about stuff. And the last one is the kinesthetic, which is the glorified title for doing it, basically. So that'd be going out and refereeing in our context. So just with that in mind, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to show you a little image. And this is the way I always like to go through this. And I gave this, Rich pitched this one for me, actually, to use it in the course, is thinking about the IKEA model. All right. So those of you that have ever received some flat pack furniture from IKEA or wherever, will relate to this in terms of how you assemble it. OK, so it will say a lot about what your learning style is as to how you go about it. So some of you might decide to, if you're visually sort of strong in terms of your learning style, you might want to watch a video on YouTube or something like that and see how it works. That's a starting one. So if your preference was audio, how might you learn how to put it together if that was your preference? What might you do?
Podcasts.
Yeah, good. Yeah, podcasts. Or you might ring their helpline at IKEA and say, how the hell do I put this together? Yeah, okay, cool. What about read or write being your preference of learning it? What might you use to help you there?
Instructions.
Yeah, yeah, they do come out. Okay, and if you're like me and you're kinesthetic, what will you do?
Chuck the instructions away and just have a go.
Oh, absolutely right. And then at the end of it, when you've got about three bolts missing, you think, bloody hell, where do they go, you know? So yeah, but that's it. But that's the easiest way of explaining those learning styles. Now, what the key thing about this is, you're not going to be just one of those. You will be able to learn from all of them. But what I'm saying is, you will have a preference as to what the one that you feel suits you best. And for me, kinesthetic. I like to give it a go and do it and learn that way. Sometimes it bites me in the backside, sometimes it works. All right. So, and that's, and again, what you'll find out as you find out a little bit about your mentees is they will have a preference as well. And the sort of the final warning note here is, think about people's and young people's in particular attitude towards written reports. Okay, so we're going to touch on the mental report in a minute, but actually giving them that in isolation probably won't be enough. You're going to need to think about how you get the message across to help them in some other way, and maybe the report will just reinforce that. Okay, so again, that gives us some food for thought as to how that might work. Okay, anyone got any questions, any thoughts at this point? We're going through nicely, guys. We haven't got. I'm going to be on time, which is a rarity for me. That those of you that know me well, so we'll keep going if that's okay. Right. So what I'm going to do now then is I'm going to try and show you do a little bit around feedback. Okay. Because again, I think feedback is really, really important. Now, hopefully you got a picture of Simon Cowell on the screen. And those of you that have seen him on the various TV shows he's been involved in will know that he's quite forthright in his feedback on occasion. So I'm just going to sort of show an example of what his feedback is like sometimes. I'm just going to try and show you this on the screen. Is that appearing still? Can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go to the next slide then. So watch, hopefully this will work. It might not, and you might not get the sound. Let's see how it goes.
No sound, Rog.
Did you hear any of that? Yeah.
No.
No, you didn't. Okay. Well, basically, I mean, I'm not. I haven't got it on YouTube or anything. It's embedded into the presentation. But basically, guy came on, sang, "I Believe I Can Fly," not very well. Simon Cowell stopped him halfway through and said, "You came in saying you were champagne. You're more like house wine. Get off," basically. So the point there is, not very nice feedback, I think, would be the point around that one. Okay. I'm not going to bother showing you the next one because that is along the same lines, really. But what the point I was going to make really around this is, again, think about how you can structure your feedback and how you're going to work it. So when you've watched a game and you're wanting to feedback on bits and pieces, those of you that have done a bit of observing will already be adept at this because you'll have done a bit of it already. Those of you that haven't, it's just again some thoughts here. So what you've got on the screen initially is something that's we're entitling the micro review. It's a really, real simple short review for the referee, which will hopefully help them in the way they go about their business. So as you can see on there, confirming what the instant decision, non-decision was, what did you do well and why, what did you do less well and why, what would you do differently next time, give me two actions that will help you for the next time. So again, a really, real simple, short and sweet micro review on what you've seen that time, which they might come back to you with, and you can use that to give them some feedback. Another one that's been talked about is the model that's called Three Stars and a Wish. Has anybody come across that one before? So again, three stars, so three real bits of positive feedback, the wish, something they might want to develop for the next time. Again, really, really simple. And again, that links in quite closely to the form I'm gonna share with you in a minute, which you can use. Okay. Let's have a look. And then we've got the full review, potentially. So it's got the mnemonic of review down the side, as you can see there. So when you're going through with them, reassuring, reintegrate, thanks for that, I like the way, blah, blah, blah. It's fun when you establish a focus, personal and group directly. What were the objectives for the group? Or what did you do the group do to be able to do? What were your personal objectives? So again, this is quite a broader review. What went well, what went less well? Again, some questions around that. Asking people to add comments, emphasizing the key learning points, and maybe what you will do next time. So from an action planning point of view. So that one is quite useful, I think, potentially in some group review work. So again, we'll move on to that. I'll touch on how we're going to develop that going further when we get the group together. Okay. The other point I got down here. So the next thing is daring greatly. So again, this is a potential engaged feedback list. So I know I'm ready to give feedback when. So again, this is just you thinking from yourselves about how you position yourself. I'm ready to sit next to you rather than across from you. I'm willing to put the problem in front of us rather than between us. I'm ready to listen, ask questions, and accept that I may not fully understand the issue. I want to acknowledge what you do well instead of picking apart your mistakes. So this is quite a good one to remember, that we're not fault finding here. We're all about trying to help them develop. And I quite like some of the points that come out in there. And as I say, I will share that one with you so you can you can use that if you want, as a sort of baseline, some general rules of feedback. The thing about this really is general preparation tips, being prepared, staying positive, being firm, being fair, always looking to involve them. So, thinking about that, that's coming back to the point I made earlier about asking the right questions, getting them to come across with their own viewpoint so they can buy into it, and then they can come up with their own solutions rather than you having to tell them all the time. Listen actively, as we've said, be referee centered, as we've already touched on, encourage self-evaluation, self-reflection, think about learning styles, rich and rapid, keep it constructive, clear, specific, offer, don't impose, help them to identify personal goals, objectives, things that they want to develop and change going forward. All right, so again, some daring greatly, I think, is again a good little feedback list to go back to. Okay, then we that's sort of verbal feedback, obviously. And like I said, I think that works out really well when you've got a chance to chat some at the end. If you haven't, in the current climate, so bearing in mind we'd like to go live in January, we're still going to be in a situation of lockdown. Those of you that have been on the receiving end of observations now will obviously have had a Zoom or Microsoft Team chats with your observers rather than face-to-face at the end of the game. I guess that's the way we're going to have to work with our mentees to start with initially. Okay, so think about the best way we can do about that, and how we can make that as interactive as possible in this difficult medium. Okay, and then the written feedback. So again, how are we going to work that? So just to share with you, what I put up on the screen is a copy of the form I will send out to you that we use at the moment. Really, really simple. Again, I've not plagiarized the core form or made it or used that one or made it very complicated. I've kept it simple. Again, your feedback around this and how we can develop it forward is, you know, greatly received, guys. So at the moment, though, all I'm looking at is the form will have the name of the referee, the competition, the date, one development area, potentially, three areas of strength, additional comments box, name of you as observer or mentor, and signature and date at the bottom, okay? Again, I've squeezed it onto there, so you don't actually see the actual scope of it. I mean, the boxes and putting a bit more detail on there is something that you can obviously develop yourselves. But that's the form I'd like you to use to start with. The point I mentioned earlier, though, is again, think about how your mentees actually receive it as to whether they want it in that format, whether that's the best thing for them. You might find that they want it a different form. They might, you know, you might want it by WhatsApp, they might want an email, or some other form to use that way. Okay, so that's again something for food thought. So again, think about how they want it. From my point of view, I think it's really good to have this, because ultimately it enables me then to collate what's coming in, what sort of stuff you guys are putting on there, and equally, as we go forward and we develop this into a group, it's identifying areas of development. So if you're all talking about their positioning not being great, then that's something we can do some work on, or if their player manager needs a bit of work, etc. So all of these things are coming out in your reports that are coming back in, and I know what we need to work on and some of the areas we can have a look at going forward. Okay, so that's the point of that. Anyone got any questions, any pointers around that? Does that make sense? Yeah. Silence is golden. Okay. To be honest with you, we've gone through this quite quickly. The last string really is what you're seeing up there now, which is just a little bit more meat on the bones, if you like, for where we're going with this into the new year. So as I say, at the moment, I'm just looking to finalise the group, who's going to be in it. They are broad ranging. There's some of them that are at the bottom end, just, you know, 16, 17. There are others that are, you know, into their 20s, but equally want some help to progress, which is great. What I'm proposing, as I say, I've got the resource to be able to do this, is to pay you guys £20 each time you go out and mentor one of these. So that'll literally be going out, watching them, and then just doing one of those simple reports. I don't want, you know, big observation or anything, or chapter and verse. I won't ask you to go big distances. I'm not proposing to include any mileage in that. So again, it'll be ideally you're going to see someone that's quite close to you, so you're not travelling too far. And as I said, I'll give you £20 for each one of those. And then we'll see how that develops going forward. Any of you that are involved in any other mentoring, again, and what I'm looking to do is to bump up potentially what we're able to pay mentoring, because I think it is a really important area going forward. And I'm delighted that you guys have shown the inclination to want to get involved at this point. So that's where we are in that respect. I've been in touch with the guys who've applied to suggest a meeting on the 7th of January. So that's going to be the next time I would look to get us together. Now, what we'll do that night is I'll make sure Sam's on here to help me so we can go into breaking rooms and stuff like that. I will make sure at that point that I have allocated you with a referee. With the numbers we've got at the moment, it's perfect, because I'm not going to give you more than one referee. I need to at the moment, because there's so many of you that have shown that interest, which means it's great. You get an opportunity to go out and do the three games potentially, despite all the various disruptions we're getting with lockdowns and weather and stuff as we go into the new year. What we'll need to bear in mind is, to start with, some of them will be predominantly doing their games in youth football. So it might be that you watch them in a game of youth football, but as I've alluded to already, that needs to sort of progress towards adult football in the not too distant future. That's really what we're looking for. Okay, the other thing to say is then I look to get another meeting maybe late February, March time, just to get us all together, talk about how things have been developing, again collate some general points that you've come up with and some general development areas, and we'll do it as a bit of CPD. So again, at the moment it'll probably be like this, but hopefully all being well, as we get into spring, we might get a chance to get out and about again. We could do some practical bits up at Oaklands or whatever. Okay, so again, it's very much a sort of blank canvas at the moment in terms of where we go with this as a development group going forward. But the numbers as they stand lend themselves to being a nice little group that we can develop together, we can push them forward together as a group, and get them refereeing adult football as a starting point, and then look to progress them 7-6 and so on. Okay. Anybody got any thoughts, concerns, questions around that at all? Does that make sense so far? Yeah. The only other thing to be mindful of is those of you that haven't got current CRC checks or safeguarding, because you're going to be doing mentoring, and even if they are sort of over 18, you're still going to need to have the various bits and pieces in place. So again, I'll be in touch with you to follow that up, just to make sure that you're all good to go on that when we're up and running in the new year. Okay, right, I've whistled through that. Thanks for your involvement tonight, and thanks for listening, those of you that haven't taken the plunge. Thanks to those of you that are working and watching it as well, Luke, so thank you for that. I have recorded it. I will look to circulate that to All and Sunny. So again, you can have a look at it yourselves. I will get the blank mental form out to you. I'll get an expenses form out as well. I'll get a copy of the presentation out so that you can use that for your reference. And then I'll be looking to invite you again. I'll send another invite for that meeting when we come back after Christmas on the 7th of Jan. Okay. So thanks again, guys. Really, really appreciate it. And yes.
Sorry, just a quick one. Obviously, in terms of our own refereeing, what kind of time frame do we need to do these three games over? Yeah. Because
it's not going to
like our own season at risk because of it.
Guys, you're all active officials. I'm not expecting this to take priority over your own games. This, when you watching the guys, will fit in as and when you can. So it might take you, you know, a couple of months to get three games in with them, to be honest with you. If that happens, so be it. It's the way it will be. Ideally, I wouldn't want you going out and sort of seeing them one game after the other anyway. It'd be like, watch them, let them have a few games on their own, and then go and watch them again. The key to this will be, obviously, watching them is really, really important. I think we've talked about that earlier with the 70-20-10 model. But just as important will be their contact with you in between their games. So their opportunity, just like you guys have with your coaches, to have that interaction with them outside of the game, see how games are going. If they are, for example, on the promotion scheme, I don't think any of them are, but one or two of them might be. They might want to share observations with you. It's just a chance, again, to bounce stuff off you. You're there as someone that's been there, seen it, done it, that they can use as a point of reference to run past stuff past you and hopefully help learn, develop, move forward. All right, so that's the point. So what you do in between games is almost as important as what you're able to do on a game itself. Okay, and I'm not going to say to you, oh, you must get your three games done in a certain time scale, because I know it's not going to work like that. We're going to have more lockdowns, let's face it. There's going to be more disruption along the way. We'll work around it. If it takes you the best part of the rest of the season to get the three games in, so be it. They've still got that help and development that hopefully will put them in a good place for next year. All right, that's where I'm coming from. All right, so don't feel pressurized to coming off games to make sure you watch these guys. That's not what it's about at all.
Yeah, that's great. Cheers, Roger. Thank you.
No, no problem. Okay. Anybody else got anything? Well, once again, guys, really appreciate your time. Busy time coming up to Christmas. Goes about to say, I hope you all have a great break. It's been a blooming hard year. Let's hope 2021 is a bit easier for all of us. And keep in touch, and I'll be out with some more stuff going forward. And good luck with any games you've got over the Christmas period. May the ball run kindly for you. And be in touch again soon. All right. Take care, guys.
Thanks, Rob.
Cheers,
Rob.
Thanks,
Rob. Yeah. Thanks, Rob.
Yeah. Yeah.
Merry Christmas.
Bye. Bye.
So who's that barking?
It's not me.
Cheers, all.
Cheers, guys. Take care.